go.
Hello, everybody. Hi. Thank you so much, all of you, for joining us tonight. Welcome to We the People, a Multicultural Arts Night. My name is Alex Pepperman, Soho Shake's Artistic Director.
And I'm Laura Yumi Snell, Soho Shake's Executive Director. So we want to thank you so much for joining us today. We have tons of presentations coming up in the new year, and we hope that you'll follow us on Facebook and Instagram at Soho Shakes. And please visit our website at www.sohoshakes.com to sign up for our mailing list. During this live event, you will be able to leave comments and ask questions during using the Q&A feature down below. We'll be personally monitoring in real time and saving some of your questions for Act Two, our post-show talkback with amazing guests like author Yumi Sakugawa, actors Jason Janeo and Sara Seyed, and a last-minute special guest, Navid Negahban from Apple TV's Tehran.
We ask that you stay mindful that this is happening live, so if technical difficulties like we just experienced at the beginning here do occur, please stick around with us and rest assured that we are doing everything we can to fix the issue. As a nonprofit organization, we rely on the generosity of our audiences so we can keep creating content. Over the past 9 months alone, we have produced 10 free online shows and held over 130 hours of free classes. In doing so, we have raised thousands of dollars for worthy nonprofits helping homeless LGBTQ plus youth and New Yorkers living with HIV. With a donation from you, we can continue the work at hand. In lieu of paying for a ticket, we suggest a donation of $15, but please feel free to contribute anything you can to help us do even more next year. You can contribute directly through our website, sohoshakes.com/donate, or if it's simpler, go ahead and Venmo us at Soho Shakes.
Please be mindful that some of the content you're about to see may not be appropriate for viewers under the age of 13. Tonight, we bring to you, from the comfort of your home, an extraordinary cast of artists from all disciplines and all walks of life. This multicultural group exemplifies the America we know and love. These are the people of We the People. That statement, We the People, now in 2020, means all people. Every single person living in our country is included in that phrase, though the representation is not where it needs to be yet. In order to make the changes we need in this country, we ask that you stay engaged. Stay engaged in our democracy, because this election isn't over yet. The results of the upcoming Georgia runoffs will directly affect the incoming administration's ability to function. We need strong leadership now to fight COVID effectively and to build the social safety nets we all deserve so that we can get back together and back into theaters again. So if you or a friend lives in Georgia or a grandma and they turn 18 before January 5th, they're eligible to vote. So you just have to register by this coming Monday, December 7th. If you want to find out more about how to vote or how you can volunteer to help, you can visit votesaveamerica.com/state/Georgia. Maybe I'll put that in the chat for you, so it'll make it easier. And even beyond January 20th, let's stay engaged so that we can build a better world together.
Now, you've heard enough out of us. So without further ado, please sit back, relax, and enjoy We the People, a Multicultural Arts Night.
Yes, and we have a lovely emcee to start us off. Her name is Kristina Stasi. She is a multiracial actress, singer, comedienne, currently residing in San Francisco Bay Area. Before the pandemic, she was seen performing in New York City with her Magnet Theater House sketch team, Newport, and the all-ladies hip-hop improv team, DMXX. They are amazing, so I hope we get to see one of their live performances again soon. During the pandemic, Kristina has continued to work on her parody songs and even taught herself to play the ukulele. Amazing. She, quote, wants to help lead the charge of breaking down the stereotypes of leading ladies because curvy ethnic girls don't just have to be the lovable sidekicks anymore. Please welcome Kristina Stasi.
Hello, everyone. Hi. I feel, even though I can't see the audience, I feel the love. I feel the clapping. And if you're not clapping, please clap anyways. I can, you know, where our energy's connected, we can feel it. Hi, Laura.
Yeah. Hi, Chrissy Missy.
Well, you know, Chrissy's my nickname. That's reserved for a small, you know, very small group of my close friends. But since I have known Laura since college, I will allow the Chrissy. And, you know, after this show, we'll all be very good friends. So if you do call me Chrissy, I will gladly accept it.
Amazing.
Oh, my goodness. Oh my gosh. We've been friends since college, which was a very long time ago, which I don't want to talk about.
It's okay. That's fine. And we did theater and a cappella together. And I remember you were in this really cool mixed race club.
Yeah, the Mixed Student Union, which was nice. So cool because it was the first time I got to meet other mixed race kids. I had never really thought of myself as mixed race until I got to college. So, you know, it's been nice to like come into my identity more.
Yeah. Speaking of mixed race, how often do people ask you about your ethnicity?
All the time, and they never get it right.
Well, may I ask, what mix are you? Or is that not allowed?
No, that's fine. Yeah, my dad is Italian and my mom is East Indian. Nice. And, you know, I think it's a fun conversation starter. And I don't mind it, but I could see if other mixed race kids might not enjoy that question. I think it's better to say what your ethnicity is rather than where are you from. And at least for me, if someone asks where are you from, I'm always like, oh, you mean my city and state, because they might hear like the California accent or something. So I don't take offense to it, but I know a lot of people do. But if someone straight up were like, but where are you from? I'd be like, okay, calm down. Why do you care?
Where are you from?
Well, I think we should get this show started. What do you think?
Yeah, let's do it. Take it away, Chrissy.
Well, as Laura said, I am Kristina. Welcome to We the People, a Multicultural Arts Night. This is an extra special show because this is Soho Shake's annual fundraiser, and all donations made will go back to local artists who, because of the pandemic, need the extra support right now. So please give whatever you can throughout the show. We'll be updating you on where we are in the fundraiser. And if your friends or family can't see the show tonight, if you can ask them to help donate, that'd be so appreciative. So, you know, we've officially hit the holiday season, and that also means 2020 is almost over. So what better way to celebrate those two things than with an original video by Venezuelan-born theater artist David Mila.
Hello, everyone, and welcome. Thank you for joining me on this beautiful winter evening. As we enter the holiday season, we prepare ourselves to say goodbye to the old year and hello to the new year. And boy, what a year it has been. 2020. Woo! If you made it this far, don't get cocky. We still have quite possibly the most difficult challenge ahead of us. Our families during the holidays.
Come on!
So, to help you break the ice, I've compiled a Christmas album called Christmas 2020. Now that's what I call drama. With holiday favorites such as, Baby, It's COVID Time. I really can't stand it's COVID time. Get 6 feet away,
baby, it's COVID time.
Your germs in my face.
With myself all this time.
Oh, I can tell.
I've sanitized my chest and thighs.
Of course, it wouldn't be the holidays if we didn't have favorites such as Grandma Got Corona in Dakota.
Grandma got Corona in Dakota. North or south, it's all the same to me. You can say you don't believe in Fauci. I'm sure your little grandma would disagree.
Or, how about one for the kids? I saw mommy reading QAnon. Could forget everyone's favorite tune, Rudy, the pervert lawyer. You know Weinstein, R. Kelly, Mike Jackson, and Clinton, Donald, Polanski, Bill Cosby, and Epstein. But can you recall the most famous pervert of all? The pervert lawyer had his hands inside his pants, and if you ever see him, please avoid that creepy glance. Oh! And finally, we end with something for the whole family. You're a mean one, Mr. Mitch. You're a mean one, Mr. Mitch. You really are a dick. You won't help with unemployment. You're spineless as a fish, Mr. Mitch. When you look in the mirror, do you ever go, gobble, gobble? You turkey neck looking bitch. I'd like to say thank you for joining me this evening, and happy holidays. Good luck.
Hello, David, are you there?
Hey, how's it going?
Oh my goodness, that video. I'm a huge fan of parodies. What inspired you to write these?
Yeah, so I wanted to make a funny video about serious topics. And I think after the year that we all had, we could use a good laugh. So I think satire and humor is a really good way to, it's an effective way to make change.
Absolutely. And you are also the artistic director for the Possibility Project. Can you tell the viewers a little bit more about that?
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm one of the artistic directors for the Possibility Project, and they are a theater for social change organization that works with New York City teenagers to create original musicals based off of their own lives and some of the issues that they're dealing with. This year, we're not going to be able to meet in person, so we're doing a virtual program, and instead we'll be creating an original podcast based off of their lives. It will be written, directed, and performed by them. that's what we're doing this year.
Yeah, I think that's been so amazing how more people have gotten into creating podcasts, because it is this great new platform for doing shows and you know, getting to put yourself out there in a way that is really accessible and, you know, in lieu of live theater. So I think that's great. So, You know, I know 2020 has been a little crazy. What holiday traditions have you missed the most this year because of the pandemic?
Yeah, I think that one of the things that I'm gonna miss is more so sitting around the table and kind of like we just did, laughing about some of the things that happened throughout our year, right? Signifies sort of like the end of something and the beginning of something new. So I'll miss that, but it's also possible through Zoom. So I'll be doing
absolutely.
That.
Absolutely, yeah. As long as, you know, we can see each other face to screen, that's good enough, and we're all staying safe and healthy.
It's something for sure. Yeah, and staying safe is number one.
Well, thank you for sharing your talent with us. Can you please let the audience know where they can find you on social media, or if you have, and or if you have any upcoming shows?
Yeah, so you can follow me at Miggy Mila. That's MiggyMila, listed on my name right there.
I see it.
And yeah, I plan on just creating more content. That was my first video, so I plan on creating a lot more.
And you do that just through iMovie, and I know you said you're going to now start doing them on Adobe, so I can't wait to see them get even better.
Yeah, right on, right on. It's the beginning of a long process for sure.
Well, thank you so much. And hopefully we'll see you soon.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Right, bye. Okay, our next performer is a Chinese American actress, director, and singer who, like me, is from the San Francisco Bay Area. Yay. Performing Phoebe's monologue from As You Like It, here's Angela Lavery.
Think not I love him, though I ask for him. 'Tis but a peevish boy, yet he talks well. But what care I for words? Yet words do well when he that speaks them pleases those that hear. It is a pretty youth, not very pretty. But sure he's proud, and yet his pride becomes him. He'll make a proper man. The best thing in him is his complexion, and faster than his tongue did make offenses, I did heal it up. His leg is but so-so, and yet 'tis well. There's a pretty redness in his lip, a little riper and more lusty red than that mixed in his cheek. 'Twas just a difference betwixt the constant red and mingled damask. There be some women, Silvius, had they marked him in parcels as I did, would have gone near to fall in love with him. But as for my part, I love him not, nor hate him not. And yet I have more cause to hate him than to love him. For what had he to do to chide at me? He said mine eyes were black and my hair black, and iron remembered scorned at me. And marvel why I answered not again. That's all one. Omittance is no quittance. I'll write to him a very taunting letter, and thou shalt bear it. Wilt thou, Silvius?
Hi, Angela. Hey. That was awesome. Hey. So, of course, Soho Shakes, of course, we, you know, have to have a Shakespeare monologue. What is your connection to this monologue? Tell me why you decided to choose this one.
Yeah, so this was a fun piece for me to learn. It's definitely one of the first Shakespeare pieces I've ever learned. I just love how comedic it is, but kind of, you know, the way I play it is not like your typical way of playing it. That's what I've heard. So I think just like me finding like my own personal like connection to it was just so much fun. The way I see Phoebe is so much the way that I see like life in general, like me. And, you know, I always, you know, like finding the way for this monologue to click was just, I actually kind of like used some Chinese, like today I was like arguing with my mom and I realized like, this is exactly what this monologue is. And it's just like, it's so funny. So like, it was fun for me to be able to like bring my cultural, like, you know, like meanness into it, so.
Absolutely. Yeah. I think that's what people want to see when, you know, you do a monologue from Shakespeare. Like if you wanted to see it be done the regular way, you would watch, you know, your favorite, you know, film version of it or something. So when they want to see a performer do it, they want to see that, you know, your own take on it, your own twist on it. So, yeah.
People who don't understand Shakespeare, I think it's all about what you make of it too.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's a heightened language and you have to find your own way to make it your own and connect to the audience. Mm-hmm. So I know you trained as an opera singer originally. What made you decide to eventually move over to musical theater and acting?
Yeah, so after I studied opera, I moved to New York and I studied at Cap 21, where I had really fabulous acting training from Larry Arencio, known as Lady Gaga's coach to most people. And, you know, just the way he described acting, it was just so, so just human, I guess. It's really all about breathing and it's really all about just being present and aware. And I started just bringing that into my everyday life. Like walking around the city, being super present and aware. And I realized how much joy it brought me.
And so are you trying to be the Lady Gaga of musical theater then? No. You know, it's okay. I'll try to be the Lady Gaga of comedy. There we go. Oh, yeah. Well, thank you so much for sharing your monologue today and your talent. Can you tell the audience where they can find you on social media and if you happen to have any upcoming shows?
Yeah, so you can see my handle right down here. It's at Ms. Angie Lavery. As for shows, hope to be doing some in-person performing once all this chaos is over.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much and hope to see you soon.
Bye, Kristina.
Bye, Angela. All right, our next performer is a Japanese-American multi-talented artist originally from LA. She also happens to be Soho Shake's own executive director and my friend, singing a special rendition of Que Sera Sera. Here's Laura Yumi Snell.
When I was just a little girl, I asked my mother, what will I be? Will I be pretty? Will I be rich? Here's what she said to me. Que sera, sera. Whatever will be. The future's not ours to see. Que sera, sera. 私が小さい時ママに聞きました美しい娘になれるでしょうか Que sera, sera なるようになるわ先のことなどわからない Que sera, sera Whatever will be Future's not ours to see. Que sera, sera. Someday I'll have children of my own. They'll ask their mother, what will I be? Will I be handsome? Will I be rich? I'll tell them tenderly. Que sera, sera. Whatever will be. The future's not ours to see. Que sera, sera. What will be. Que sera.
Beautiful.
Oh, thank you.
What made you decide to do this bilingual version of Que Sera Sera?
Well, thanks for asking. So this summer, on top of everything happening, 2020 was a really tough one because I got the news in July that my mom was sick with stage 3 colon cancer. And I was like, oh, that's horrible. And in August, she got her surgery. She's okay now, so everything's good. But, oh, we have someone joining us.
Hi, Hallie.
Hi, friend. Hi, Hallie.
Hi. there we go.
Hi, Hallie.
Bye, Hallie.
Anyway, we got the bad news. She's good now, so I will tell that first so no one gets worried. But, you know, Chadwick Boseman had the exact same diagnosis, and I heard about his death, and it was a lot of things on top of a lot of other things. And I was having a particularly down day driving in the dark, and this song came on the radio, and I heard the lyrics again as an adult, because my mom used to sing this to me all the time when I was a kid in Japanese. So this was sort of a tribute to her and her strength. And she taught me, like, there are things that are in your control and other things that are not. What will be, will be. And I love this song now, because first I was like, oh no, is this like, I want to be pretty and rich. Am I shallow and materialistic? And it's like, no. Pretty on the inside and rich and abundant in my friendships and what I want to do with my life.
So and love.
That's how I'm interpreting it. And love. Yes.
Love. So do you think we'll be hearing more bilingual songs from you?
Ooh, yes. Totally. Yeah. 100%.
Awesome. Well, I can't wait to hear them. Thank you so much. Do you want to tell the audience how they can find you on social media and if you have any other upcoming shows?
Yeah. Well, you can find me right here, Laurie Yumi Snell, on my Instagram, which I never post on, but I can be a little better. Also, I got kicked out of my Facebook, so I have to email them and let them put me back in. So I'm a hot mess, but you can find me, and I'm working on a couple of developmental pieces. One is a Shakespeare adaptation, and another is an original story. So hopefully you'll see it in Soho Shakes, some sort of 2021 season sneak preview.
I can't wait for it. So we will see you later when you come back for Act Two, when we do the talk back with the panelists. So
right.
We will see your beautiful face again.
Thanks so much, Chrissy.
All right, bye. Our next performer is an alum of the American Academy of Dramatic Arts and runs a very popular podcast with her partner. Please welcome Alia Guidry. Alia? Alia? Hello?
Please record your message. When you finish recording, you may hang up or press 1 for more options.
Hey! I want to say something. I've been trying to be more honest lately, and I just need to say a few things. Wow, okay. I feel really good right now. Why didn't you come to my art show? I invited you, and that really sucked. It's like, sometimes you act like I don't even exist, and I called off my wedding because of you. And now we're not even friends, and that really sucks. And I miss you. I mean, you were my best friend before you went away, and I really miss you. I shouldn't have been with my ex, and there were a lot of reasons to call off my wedding, but the truth is I didn't care about any of those reasons until I met you. And now you're with someone else, and that's fine. That's fine. It's whatever. No, that's not what I mean. I'm not okay. The thing I'm trying to say to you, I guess, is that I miss having fun with you. Just you. Okay, I'm gonna go now. Yeah, today is a good day.
Hi, Alia.
Yeah.
That was amazing. Now, I know where the monologue is from, but do you want to tell the audience where it's from?
I do. So that is a little monologue from everyone's favorite show, The Office.
I love it. I love it. You know, especially because everyone thinks of The Office as this, you know, just super cringy, awkward comedy, but there really were some heartfelt moments, especially between Jim and Pam.
Totally. I agree.
Speaking of Jim and Pam and, you know, that connection, I know you and your partner have this amazing podcast and social media presence. Can you talk more about that?
Yeah, we do. We're really lucky to have a platform where we can share our voice. And it's really important to us to share the voices of those who may not have the same platform or whose voices kind of get, you know, lost. And that's really important to us. And we have a podcast where we talk about all queer things, and we do like a Q&A, and we actually have a series on there called Black Voices Matter. And we interview all sorts of Black artists just to, you know, amplify their voices. And it's a way for us to learn and just sit back and listen to them. So it's really fun for us.
I'm loving Q&A. I've never heard that before. That's so funny. I'm a huge fan of puns, so this is perfect.
We did it in the game, Martha, I have to say. I'm sure someone did it first, but it's—
Do it! If they haven't, do it! So between you and your partner, who's the Jim and who's the Pam?
Oh gosh, that's a great question. And I'm going to give you an annoying answer, but we're both a lot of Jim and a lot of Pam. So it kind of works out perfectly.
That's good. That's good. You know, there's always a balance.
Exactly. I'm more Pam some days. She's more Jim some days. But yeah.
Exactly. Well, please let the viewers know the handle is Hers and Hers. You can write
right here.
Right there on the screen, and let them know if you have any upcoming shows, or if not, hopefully you will be doing one soon, and they can find out all the info on Instagram.
That's right. Just follow us on Instagram. You'll hear about all that stuff. We'll be doing a new podcast series soon, interviewing some great queer people. So just keep in touch and you'll know.
Thank you so much, Alia. Hopefully we'll see you soon.
Got it.
Our next performer is an Emmy-nominated songwriter and performer who has written several songs for SpongeBob SquarePants and Phineas and Ferb, performing an original holiday song. Here's Michael Hirano Culross.
Do, do, do. Got to get this going. Christmas. I forgot which day is Christmas. Was it just the other day, or is it as of yet still months away? Should I wrap all these presents up or stow them all away? I'm confused and I don't know when to hang my stockings. Is Santa out on holiday, or will he come a knocking? Shall I put some cookies out, or can I feel free to cry and pout? Well, I thought that I was up to date, but now I have my doubts. January 1st, oh no, no, that's New Year's Day. February gave my heart away. What April Fool am I anyway? What am I to do? Ooh. I feel like I'm being watched by somebody who works at the North Pole. Maybe not. June 21st, I'm out working on a tan. October, trick-or-treating, pale in hand. November, no, that's my birthday, man. What am I to do? Ooh, I forgot which day is Christmas. Please somebody clue me in, or I won't know when it's Christmas. I feel like such a ditz because my calendar's gone on the fritz. Should I expect the Easter Bunny or Comet, Cupid, and Blitzen? I went a syllable too long, didn't I? Never mind.
of breath at the end. Near enough. I nearly got that through that without fainting.
Oh no, you were great. Michael, so everyone in the audience, I was not expecting this setup, this background. It is beautiful.
What's that?
I mean, you're
so you noticed the new hat.
Yeah.
I figured, you know, Christmas, I'll get a new hat.
The hat, the tree, the elf on the shelf, the stockings in the back. I am.
Well, the stock, you know, that line is always there. I usually, you know, have my wash hanging there. I didn't want to show off, you know, my panties hanging on the line.
Very fair.
It's a family show, isn't it?
Absolutely, it is. Hi, Mikey.
Hi, oh, thanks for having me. You know, I think I said it when we did the last one of these showcases. Everybody on this is so talented. And, you know, what's the old line? You ever feel like the world's a room full of tuxedos and you're a pair of brown shoes? Well, I think that was the
no,
line.
No, everyone before. Is so talented, including yourself. Come on, you're an Emmy nominated songwriter.
You get the check.
Tell me more about this song.
So you mentioned Phineas and Ferb. I still am in this band. We used to, you know, play out and play around, did moderate touring and whatnot. And one of the fellows in the band was a guy called Dan Povenmeyer. He's still called Dan Povenmeyer. And he eventually became the co-creator of Phineas and Ferb. And one of the things we used to do, we used to have a decent following of people, of fans. And we had a rather extensive mailing list. And one year, rather than send out Christmas cards, we thought, wouldn't it be fun to record sort of an audio Christmas card, write an original song? And we did that, and we sent out cassette tapes, if you're old enough to remember that. And we would, you know, write and record the song and then have, 500, 600 or 800, however many it was, cassette tapes. And we'd send them out and pay for it. And that was good fun. And it became sort of a tradition of doing it every year. And this one was just kind of a silly thing. It's like I was laying on my bed looking at a calendar thinking, what if you forget? You know, because you forget birthdays, anniversaries, who forgets Christmas?
But, right. Know. No one.
But
that's
no, it was,
awesome.
It was great fun. And that was one of the great parts of being in that band is that kind of challenge. Because we got to step out of being our usual selves. And, you know, one of them would be like that. One was kind of a folk music one. One was a hard rock. We did a jazz sort of thing. And it was great fun. We had a good time. Well, we enjoyed it anyway.
Marty said that they actually have a tape. So that is very exciting.
Yeah, see, Marty does have it. One of the fellows on the chat, Marty's brother, Carl, was our lead guitarist.
Oh, perfect.
Who was small, very instrumental world. In coming up with that. That nice little chord bit for that song. So he and his brother, they're beautiful guys.
Well, hopefully you'll be doing more, you know, holiday songs in lieu of holiday cards, because it'd be wonderful to hear more.
Well, you know, Arbor Day is coming soon.
That's very true. Well, thank you so much, Mikey.
Thanks for having me. I really do appreciate it.
Yeah, of course. Do you want to plug any of your social medias? In case people want to get to know you more.
I'm not going anywhere. Oh, wait, social media is online, isn't it? Yes, you can find me at Facebook. It's michael.culross. I think they can see it on the screen. And I have an Instagram account. It's there somewhere. Find me. I'm the only Michael Culross literally on the planet. So find me there. So thanks again.
Thank you so much. It was great to see you again.
And happy Christmas, everybody. And
Happy Christmas, yeah.
A better new year for all of us.
And absolutely.
This one's been a little rough. Yeah, a little bit. So I'm bored with it. Let's move on to 2021.
Here, here. All right. Thanks, Mikey.
Thanks a lot.
All right, bye.
For the elf.
All right, our next performer, now is our first update for our donations. If you haven't already, please go to sohoshakes.com/ this way, donate to, or I believe we're also on Venmo. Please give whatever you can so we can help artists who are in need. I believe Antonio was going to update me on the number. What do we have so far? Antonio?
Kristina, we're at $3,549.
Oh my goodness, that's amazing. Thank you so much for everyone who's contributed so far. That it's awesome. I can't wait for the next update. Hopefully it'll be 5,000 or 6,000, maybe, fingers crossed. In the meantime, let's continue our show. Our next performer is of Cherokee and Algonquin descent and has been a longtime artist ensemble member of the Native Voices at the Autry. Performing an excerpt from an original story, please welcome Samantha Bowling.
So my freshman year in high school, we go on a mission trip to McDowell County, West Virginia, which I think is weird. I thought the point of a mission trip was to convert poor people to Christianity. All my life in church, I've heard about those poor, hopeless souls in China who've never heard of Jesus, or those poor, hopeless souls in Africa who've never heard of Jesus, or whatever. Africa sounds dope. And you can twist my arm and take me to China anytime, but West Virginia, that's one state over from where I'm growing up in Ohio. Pretty sure they already have Jesus in West Virginia because my family is from there and my family is very pro-Jesus. My grandmother loves Jesus and she grew up in West Virginia. And this particular part of West Virginia is also part of the ancestral lands of the Cherokee, and my family's Cherokee. As we drive through the Smoky Mountains, we learn that this used to be a popular mining town and that when the coal boom abruptly ended, everybody left and it's now a ghost town. We pass what used to be grocery stores that are now abandoned warehouses, and what used to be government buildings that are now abandoned warehouses, and what used to be churches that are now vibrant and thriving. It's actually quite beautiful here. The mountainscapes are breathtaking and everything looks lush. I wonder why anyone would leave here as I watch vines crawl through shattered windows of houses nearly burned up, the green covering up gray. We pull up to the abandoned high school where we'll be staying. You heard that right, abandoned high school. This place is so poor that the property taxes the town brings in don't cover the expenses of running a school. So the very few children in the area are all homeschooled. My group is tasked with going to a nice old lady named Luann's house and playing with hammers on her roof. You may deduce from this that we are replacing her roofing, which might happen. But do you think a bunch of 15-year-olds are at all qualified to fix a roof, even at our most attentive, let alone on vacation with a bunch of hot teens from other schools? On our first day, we climb up the ladder onto the roof and we get to hammering. We just hammer all over the place. There is hammering being done, despite how you use it, or depending on how you use it. A hammer is a tool for either building or for destruction. And if you build like a bunch of 15-year-olds, it's both. At lunchtime, I ask where I might wash my hands, you know, from all the hammering. And I'm met with, God made dirt, so dirt don't hurt. And I think, hate to break it to you, but according to the people at my church, God also made AIDS, and AIDS, I have heard, are painful, depending on, you know, how many of them you have in your system. If I insist on washing my hands, I am told I can do so inside Luann's house. I go inside, and even though it's the middle of a bright, sunny June day, it is very dark. There are no curtains on the windows and very little decoration on the walls. I walk up to the sink and turn the knob, and no water comes out. I got your water right here, says a voice behind me. I turn and see Luann, wearing a pink striped nightgown and carrying a tin pail full of water. She tells me she has to get her water from the spigot outside because the plumbing broke and the church people haven't gotten around to fixing it yet. I say, thank God for the church, right? And she looks at me over her glasses. I'm just like, do you have any soap? She rolls her eyes at me and grabs a can of Comet from an otherwise empty cupboard and sets it on the counter before she turns to go back into her room. I say, sorry, I mean like hand soap to wash my hands. She says, honey, that's all I can afford. If you want soap, here you go. I wonder how much Comet costs as I rub the grainy paste between my wet hands. On the van ride back to the high school, I ask our group leader about Luann. He says, she lives alone and doesn't have any family. She's not a member of the church, but she was invited when she came to apply for help with her roof. She's never come to the services. I guess she has no intention of converting. I wonder if Luann's is the kind of life you get stuck with if you don't. I think that's the scariest thing in the world, to have to live like that. I often throughout my life find myself thinking back to what our lives on this continent used to be like before the outsiders came. I think a lot about what a day in the life might have been like for my ancestral grandmother that lived on these lands, and it's easy to imagine. She, like Luann, was incredibly self-sufficient. She didn't go to a spigot to get her water. She went to a river where she washed herself every day at dawn. And she didn't use soap because back then God really had made dirt, and dirt really didn't hurt because it wasn't corrupted by chemical contaminants. She likely believed in a benevolent higher power like God, but they were genderless and she called them creator. She ate food she planted herself, which was possible before coal dust acidified the soil, or fish she trapped herself, which was possible before damming prevented fish from traveling upriver to spawn. Poverty wasn't a thing, as wealth was measured not by what you had, but by what you were comfortable sharing. And everyone took only what they needed from the environment they spent their life with in stewardship, trusting that it would provide as it had since time immemorial. Zaragi was the word in her language she would have used to identify her land. Zaragi is the same word in her language she would have used to describe her people. She saw herself as part of the land, not above it, as if her people were the soul of the land made manifest. When the colonizers made their way up north to remove native families from their homes, they sometimes would let people stay if they converted to Christianity, or if members of the local churches vouched for their good Christian character. Manifest destiny dictated that the white man's God had promised them our land, so we had to get on board or get out. They would burn Indian villages to start again with a clean slate, sometimes with native families trapped inside their houses. The US government claimed custody over Indian children to put them in boarding schools to force assimilation and convert them to Christianity in order to kill the Indian and save the man. In these schools, they would cut our hair, which we believe to be a manifestation of our souls. So how can you save the poor, hopeless souls of Tsadagi who have never heard of Jesus if you remove their soul and replace it with a violent, extortionary patriarch, or remove the land from its soul and replace it with a cavernous coal mine robbed raw? Is that why my grandmother loved Jesus? Was it true devotion or Stockholm syndrome? And since when did the Jesus I was taught about dangle a carrot with one hand and hide a hammer behind his back with the other? Here I am, on a roof in West Virginia, hammering away. Now I'm the one dangling the carrot.
Hi, Sam. How are you doing?
I am good. I'm so happy to be here. How are you?
Yeah, good. Thank you for sharing this piece with us. Can you tell us a little bit more about it?
Sure. This piece is sort of a pared down version of a story that I wrote a little bit ago about this mission trip and sort of about me sort of trying to find my place in a society that sort of didn't make space for me in all the ways that I tried to fit myself into this box, and then sort of learned that the box was always broken. That's basically it.
I mean, yeah, but then also at the same time, it's like, why would you want to fit into that box anyways?
Right.
Make your own box, or make it a basket, make it a pot. So you have now been a part of the Native Voices at the Autry for over 6 years. Can you tell me more about this company?
Absolutely. I love them so much. They're my family. When I first came into Native Voices, I came in as a performer, as an actor. And I'd always thought that writing was something that someone else did, that it wasn't my place as an actor to be writing stuff for myself. And they were kind of like, no, absolutely not. You have things to say, try it. And I started just trying to trust my own storytelling voice, and I really love it. They've given me community, they've given me culture, they've encouraged me as an artist and as a person. I love them so much. And we have our short play festival actually up on our website now. If you go to Native Voices at the Autry, or if you could go to theautry.com/native voices, you can see a recording of our play festival. It's one of the big things that we do every year. It's
like, that's amazing. This was recorded pre-pandemic?
It was recorded during the pandemic, actually.
Oh, wow.
Virtual short play festival thing that was really fun.
Oh, that's amazing. Well, thank you so much for sharing this piece with us. Can you tell the audience where they can find you on social media?
Sure. I'm mostly on Instagram. My handle is just at the Samantha Bowling. I'm on Twitter a little bit, but I don't pay a ton of attention to Twitter because I find it a little bit frustrating. But if you insist on finding me on Twitter, I'm at second guess correct.
Perfect. I understand. Twitter can be a lot sometimes. It's just a lot. Well, thank you so much. And thank you for also plugging your show. Can you remind the site again? It's theautry.com/
theautry.com/native voices.
Perfect. Oh, and there's a request once you're done to share that link in the chat.
Sure.
All right. Thanks so much, Sam. It's nice to see you.
Thank you, too.
Bye. Our next performer is a soloist at the American Ballet Theater. Due to safety concerns, she's actually 8 months pregnant. She can't dance live for us at the moment, so please enjoy an excerpt from the special film instead. Here's Zhongjing Fang and the American Ballet Theater Company.
Thank you.
Hi, Zhongjing. Nice to meet you.
Kristina, nice meeting you too.
Thank you for having me. Yeah, of course. That was such an incredible video.
Thank you.
What inspired you to choreograph this piece?
Well, this piece was born during the height of the pandemic in April and May. And I actually live right next by a hospital. So I actually witnessed three refrigerator trucks at a time used to stow the victims of COVID. And it was really, really intense and sad, all of that. But I was very inspired by the first responders who risking their life to save so many people's lives. And at the same time, I was just questioning while the ABT dancers has lost our performing seasons and rehearsal studios that we weren't able to practice every day anymore. So I thought about what is our responsibility, not only as dancers, but also artists at that time. So the inspiration came from that. Yeah.
Wow, yeah, I can't imagine what it'd be like to live next to a hospital and see that. But I mean, also as artists, you know, it's our duty to, you know, bring that light and that love during these awful times. So thank you so much for sharing that. And also to anyone in the audience, the full video, Laura will be dropping the YouTube link in the chat. So if this was just an excerpt, it's how long is the full video?
The full video is 10 minutes.
So if you want to see the full 10-minute video, Laura will be sharing the YouTube link down below. So have you choreographed a lot with ABT, or was this one of your first ventures into choreographing?
So I've been choreographing since 2011. And yes, however, this is my very first dance film piece that also not only is a dance film, but also we did everything through Zoom meetings. So it was quite challenging.
Yeah, and but also the locations that the dancers chose were just beautiful. The one that was like in between two mountains, I was like, oh my God, where is this place? It's so gorgeous.
In Colorado.
Yeah. Well, I mean, but that's the great thing though, is that you'd be able to film in places that you wouldn't have normally because everyone would have been in New York. So it's nice to see, you know, where people are sheltering in place. And hopefully if it's not too much work, you could be doing another one of these soon.
I actually recently just done another piece for ABT. It's in a studio and it's part to do, but it probably won't show until 2021.
Ooh.
Yeah. Yeah, since you have mentioned about the space, I did have to say the title perception, that's where, you know, nowadays we face to each other on Zoom meetings. And what's your perception? What's your stage of your life, right? What is the picture you see in front of you? That's somehow very important. And I hope that this piece will give people hope and encouragement to see things in a different, difficult time, to see things positively.
Yeah. Absolutely, yeah. Well, you know, actually, I was so inspired by your film that I decided to make my own dance video. Ooh, so great. I think we should watch that right now.
Great.
Look at me. Or Hawaiian, no one knows who I am.
myself now, I guess. I wanted to do a parody video for We the People, and I had just seen the APT video that we just saw, and I was like, well, what if I did my own dance video with my parody song? I actually did that in like a day, but all these stuff is really fun. I love doing parody videos. I wrote it because, you know, like we talked before about being mixed race, everyone always mistakes my ethnicities, and they get mad when I correct them. They're like, what? But you have to be half Portuguese. I'm like, oh, but I'm not. And then, so it's funny how people get really, they want to relate so bad that they you know, want to connect with you however they can. But, you know, it's just my identity. I don't have to prove it to anyone. Moving on, our next performer is an actress, model, and dancer currently living in New York with her boyfriend and adorable new puppy who may or may not make a cameo. Performing an original poem, here's Sharlee Taylor.
Convection. I sit peacefully on a crumbling tower, and I pretend I do not feel the cracks. There is an earthquake, rumbling, 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 but I get groceries, walk dog. I smile and laugh at the people around me who also ignore the signs. This morning, a breeze near knocked me over, and it smelled like the pungent smoke of worlds burning not too far away. And still, I sit peacefully, cross-legged, and I pretend I do not feel the cracks. This afternoon, a rainstorm near washed me away, and I was baptized in the sea of salt tears. But still, I sit peacefully, eyes closed, breath deep, and I pretend I do not feel the cracks. Tonight I hear footsteps in the distance and small pieces of my world fall apart, but I tell myself they are in my head. I feel fires burning, but I tell myself they are in my head. I hear footsteps echoing, but they're in my head. I tell myself, I tell myself, I tell myself, I tell me that they are all in my head. And I sit peacefully, cross-legged, on a near crumbling tower, and I pretend I do not feel the cracks.
Hi, Sharlee, nice to see you again.
You as well. Thank you so much for having me. I'm so happy to be here.
Yeah, of course. So that was an original poem that you wrote. Can you tell me more about it?
Yeah, I feel like it came from a place that I think we're all experiencing right now of just like confusion in our lives from both the people that are supposed to be in charge to things that are totally outside of our control, like COVID, like climate change, and it all feels so overwhelming to me. And I both feel like I wanna help change things, but also don't know how to help and don't know where to contribute. And sometimes I like have all these feelings of wanting to do something, and then I'm like, okay, I don't know what to do, and I just kind of fall back into normalcy. So it kind of came from this place of both feeling such a strong urge to do something and also not knowing what that something is I should be doing.
Absolutely. But, you know, I feel like as artists, you know, we are doing things in our own way. And even if it doesn't affect, you know, a big group, as long as it's affecting one person, I feel like that's something.
For sure.
Yeah.
It's better than nothing.
Better than nothing. Totally. So how else have you been able to stay creative during this lockdown?
Well, you know, finally enough, I didn't realize you were in a magnet team, but I took my first improv class via magnet. Virtual improv. It was great. So I've been doing that. I've been similar to what Samantha was saying before, I always saw myself as like an actor, but I've been giving myself more permission to write. So like I wrote that poem for this, for Soho Shakes. I also wrote my first pilot ever, which is super cool. Yeah, and like kind of random for me. So yeah, I think I'm just trying to experiment with ways of different ways of expressing my creativity that give me more autonomy.
And I know you expressed your creativity pre-pandemic by being a dancer at bar mitzvahs. Do you want to talk more about that?
The dark time in my life. No, I mean, we were talking before and I was saying that, you know, Tiffany Haddish was also a bar mitzvah dancer when she was getting started. So I feel like I'm on a really good path, path to success. But yeah, it's basically like I'm the hype man for this bat mitzvah. And we just get the party going. We keep the party going.
I feel like you should offer your services to beyond just bar mitzvahs, like for employee Zoom meetings, if they need a hype person. I feel like you should offer your services because clearly you can get the party started.
I got the skills. My Instagram is here.
Speaking of, we can reach her at Sharlee Taylor on Instagram and Facebook. Is that correct? And do you have any? hopefully we'll see you in some upcoming shows. Maybe even just, you know, Zoom bombing into an employee meeting where you're dancing in the back.
It's pumping. Yeah. I have no upcoming shows as of now, but maybe something will change. But I'll let people know if that happens.
Yeah. Thank you so much. It was great to see you again.
Thank you, Kristina.
All right. Our next performer is an actor and writer that's performed at amazing venues like Kennedy Center, Lincoln Center, and New Victory Theater. Please welcome Janice Amaya.
My father built a fence around our house from these things he'd found at his various jobs. It floated a few feet in the air, like it was protecting our small home from any bad thing that was 2 feet tall to 6 feet tall. Each morning, my sister and I would tear that fence down. And then by the time we got home from school, my dad would have built it up again. So then we would tear it down again. I wondered what he thought he was protecting with this fence. We didn't have much. A father who was good looking and looking for work, a mother who cleaned houses and still does, us three kids, but it certainly got us in the habit of seeing where fences were and tearing them down. My sister, Idalia, me, Janice Isolina, and my baby brother with the curly hair, Dylan. It's like our names were this migration in themselves. Idalia, El Salvador, Janice, Isolina, somewhere in between, and Dylan, which should maybe belong to a blonde surfer dude from California. But our family was built over fences. My mother and father and Theo drove to the United States in a red truck, over 2,000 miles. And when they got to the border and applied for asylee status because of all the violence back home, they were told they had to leave that red truck behind. They did. They weren't going to let the love of a red truck or the memories of their time together or the paperwork to apply for residency or anything else get in the way of them crossing to where they needed to be. Not that there weren't fences after that. There are all kinds of fences. I remember once I was with my dad and he said something to a white woman, perhaps something had fallen from her pocket or some other kind gesture, and she ignored him. And my dad said to me, "White people pretend they don't hear when I talk." And that was a kind of fence. and money, or rather when you don't have money, that's a kind of fence. But at each fence, my siblings and I somehow find a way through or around. My sister, she's a humanitarian. She'll travel the world helping people who've been affected by awful things. There was this natural disaster in Sierra Leone. The earth swallowed people and houses, and my big sister was there. And my mom and I even went to visit, because when you're dealing with such things, you might want nothing more than people who know what fences are to help you build things, tear some things down. Once I was in Tabasco, Mexico, helping some of the more recent arrivals, people whose experiences with fences is much more recent than my own. And the strangest thing was that the other people who were there to help couldn't tell what side of the fence I belong on. To tell you the truth, sometimes I don't know what side of the fence I belong on. My mom, she's sweet. She watches her kids travel the world, and I know she wishes that we were closer to her, closer to the fences, even the invisible ones. You know, we've never met the children of the families she works for. Even after all of these years and Ivy League colleges and hand-me-down clothes from them, some fences are very strong. But my mom doesn't stress about us being far away. She and our dad made sure that we were good at tearing down fences. As she says, no les puedo cortar las alitas. I would never want to cut your wings. And accents, and sexuality, and money, and death, and alcohol, and politics, and all of these things, they are all fences. But we can tear them down, and we won't let them stop us, because our parents gave us these wings so we can use them.
Hi, Janice, how are you doing?
Hi, I'm great.
Such a fantastic monologue. So that was actually an excerpt from the play Cartography by Christopher Myers, but that was written specifically for you. Mm-hmm. Can you tell more about that?
Yeah, so Cartography is a play I've been doing for a couple years, and hopefully on and through next year. But it's a show about migration and movement, and how everyone really has movement in their stories. So there's a part in it towards the end where the five performers come forward, and we each step out of our characters and tell our own personal stories. As Janice Amaya, the performer, of migration and movement. And this was mine. That we had a coffee date, and the next day he had all these beautiful pages of my story that I had never really thought of this way. But it's just like one of the best, proudest moments I have is telling the story in front of my family and having my family reimagine their narratives.
And so your family's been able to see the play.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And what did they think about it?
They love it. They love it. I mean, they're so, so proud. They come see anything I'm in. And this one, there was a show. So we first did it at the Kennedy Center, 2019, January 2019. And it was when the government was shut down because of fences, because of this border wall they're trying to build. And there were all of these newly arrived Salvadoran kids, like youth, in the front rows. And they got to see a Salvadoran on stage. And it was just normal. Not that they thought I was amazing or anything, but that was like the beginning of their story. And they're like, okay, I could go to the Kennedy Center if I want to, or I could not. But just that my family was there, and then they were kind of like little celebrities as well, was so amazing. Everyone wants to meet Dylan with the curly hair. And afterward, everyone was saying, tell Dylan I said bye. Even though I was the one on stage, they were still like so into the baby brother with the curly hair, who's actually not a baby anymore.
Aww. That's just so special to have, you know, a platform like that to hear stories from voices that you don't normally get to hear from. And I think that's so special. And, you know, the duty we have as artists to, you know, take those platforms if they're not given to us. Mm-hmm. It's very, yeah. Very, very awesome. Well, thank you so much for sharing this story with us. Can you tell the viewers where they can find you on social media?
Yeah, so I am on Instagram at Janice Isolina. I think it's in my...
Yes, I see it on the bottom.
yeah, and on there, like, I post about everything, but there's also a new... I've been staying creative by doing a little podcast with my partner here. So you get to see me acting in a totally different way, and it's silly and weird and...
I love it. What's the name of the podcast?
Vulnerable Here. It's called... Relationship Today, and it's not about relationships. So,
ooh, well, very excited to listen to it. Yeah, if you could actually post that in the chat so people can know about the podcast as well.
It's I don't even think it's a podcast, but that's what we call it. So anyway, if you're curious,
showcast. What am I into? All right, thank you so much. It's nice to see you. Of course. Bye. All right. Once again, thank you everyone for tuning in. This has been such an incredible night so far. Everyone is so talented and fantastic, and I feel honored to be a part of this show. This is the annual fundraiser. We're doing everything we can. If you haven't already, please go to sohoshakes.com/donate to please donate. Antonio, can we get an update on that number, please?
Well, Kristina, the money just keeps on rolling in from the beautiful people in Zoom land. And I can confirm that we are at $3,689 of our $5,000 goal. Thank you so much, everybody.
Oh, thank you so much. That's wonderful. Awesome. This is so great. We still have more acts for you. And during that time, you guys can be donating some more. So let's hit that 5,000 goal. All right. Thank you so much. Let's continue our show. Our next performer is an actor, musician, and voiceover artist from Boston and was last seen in Soho Shakes. That's a tongue twister. Soho Shakes online stage reading of Guards at the Taj, performing a cover of Poppies by Marcy Playground. Here's Shahjehan Khan.
When soon his majesty sent soldiers and thieves to India searching for gold, instead from the ground some magic they found, or something far better I'm told. Yeah. Yeah. story told from days of our own, when gossamer dummies ran round. They patiently wait with pieces of A, so everybody could smile one more time, yeah.
That was so awesome. Hi, Shahjehan.
Hi.
Oh my goodness. So cool. What inspired you to do this cover of Poppies tonight?
Yeah, it's interesting. It's actually, to me, it's a song about like the drug war. I don't know if the guys, I mean, it is about essentially the way that, you know, opium poppies were first cultivated. But to me, it's kind of a song about like colonialism and, you know, like the opioid epidemic and all this stuff and how it's very racialized and stuff like that. And so, again, I don't know if the dudes that wrote the song actually were thinking that, but that's the meaning that I'm going to put on it. So.
Wow. Yeah, I definitely did not think of that meaning when I first heard this song.
Yeah, I think I messed up the first line, but the first line is long, long ago in China, I'm told, to England was traded some tea. So it's kind of, it's I think it's charting the evolution of poppies.
Yeah. And you have so many creative hats. You're a voiceover artist, you're a musician, you're an actor. What medium is your favorite?
I mean, right now, I guess I'm going to go with voiceover. Music's been a little bit, it's been a little tough. I definitely miss playing live. That's one thing that I think a lot of us are probably feeling. But voiceover is something that I'm really trying to explore more in the next year. I'm hopefully launching some exciting projects and trying to like push that stuff forward a little bit.
That's awesome. That's so cool.
I'll say voiceover for now.
Yeah. you told me that you were a you also are a therapist.
No, I'm actually, that might've been, I'm not a therapist. I work more on the research side.
Oh, got it, okay.
Yeah, addiction and recovery. And actually, so I'm about to celebrate 10 years in long-term recovery from addiction. So that was another reason that I—
Congratulations.
Chose this particular piece. So, but yeah, I'm not technically a therapist, but my company studies a lot of things like addiction, prison reform, homelessness, that kind of thing.
So that's kind of, you know, those topics are always on your mind, which is probably what, when you were thinking of poppies, how you had that connection as well.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
And I sort of rediscovered this song, I would say, in the last year. Like when I was a kid, Marcy Playground, this band in the 90s, was super famous for a different song. And then I got the album when you get that, you make your parents think they're paying one penny for the 12 CDs through Columbia Music.
Yes,
end up paying like $300. So one of the CDs was this CD, and this is actually the first song on that album. This ended up being my favorite song. And when I was a kid, I totally didn't think about it, obviously, in those terms. But then coming back to the song now, I think it means something different to me.
Absolutely. But yeah, also to the Columbia thing, I think I accidentally made my parents pay $50 for some CDs. Sorry, Mom and Dad. We didn't know better. We were kids.
Right, yeah.
Thank you so much. I know I feel like we can keep on talking, but I know we have to get the show going on the road. So thank you so much. Can you please tell the viewers how they can find you on social media and if you have any upcoming shows?
Yeah, my Instagram handle thing should be in there at Shahjistan. Upcoming shows that I know of, I unfortunately don't have any that I can announce right now, but I will be hopefully doing some interesting voiceover things starting next year.
Well, it sounds like there are some awesome secret projects coming up. So obviously everyone has to follow you on social media to find out what those projects are.
Absolutely.
Well, thank you so much. It was really nice to see you and thank hopefully you we'll see you in the future.
Definitely. Thank you.
All right. Bye. All right, you're in for a real treat. Our next performer is actually one of tonight's panelists, an illuminating actress, activist, and humanitarian performing an original piece. Please welcome Sara Seyed.
I grew up in Iran, and after the revolution of 1979, Iran's schools became super conservative. Fridays were for death chants against America, and hijab, head covers, became compulsory. I remember being 13, dressed up like this little black Casper, obsessed with smuggling Backstreet Boys and Britney Spears posters into school. You know, we secretly all knew about the West, but we were good little Muslim girls and we couldn't, you know, rules were different for us. We couldn't dress sexy or do anything about our facial hair. Because, you know, teen girl facial hair is the integrity of the Nation of Islam. And I'm Persian, we're hairy motherfuckers. We grow mustache before growing breasts. I had this like Mr. Miyagi style side lip mustache. And I remember these veterans would come to our school, these fucked up soldiers would tell us about how they've, I don't know, lost a leg or a testicle, trying and fighting to preserve our honor. But one day, my aunt took me with my cousin to a salon and we got all of this sorted out, waxed off, and it was amazing. I walk into school with my sexy naked baby face and I knew I was naughty and it's gonna end bad, but my oh my, those hairy girls staring at me, I could literally remember them with a Gregorian chant behind them. Oh, it was worth it for that moment of glory. The headmistress spots me and she goes, "You, come here." And I'm summoned to a room full of mummified women, you know, all wearing burqas and hijab-like outfits, which is ironically interesting because in Islam, we also dress up the dead like that. We wrap them with cloth. And they call my home. The school used to always call my home because I was this little punk and my mother would always pretend as if she wasn't home. We can literally hear her on the speaker. "Tell them I'm not home. Tell them I'm not home." But eventually she had to turn up. And mind you, my mother is not religious. She didn't know how to wear hijab. She didn't know how to wear the long hijab. And there was no YouTube video as to how to do it back in the days. So she sweeps into school with material falling off of her, dragging all the trash from the street on her chador. They tell my mom, "Miss Seyed, out of respect for you and your family, we wanted you to be the first one to see Sara's face." My mom looks at my face as if she had nothing to do with it. And she goes, start screaming like, "Take this demon child away from me. How dare you? How dare you mess up with our integrity like that, Sara?" And they're like, she makes such a fuss about it. My headmistress had to like rub her shoulders, bring her like tea and sweet and tell her, "Don't worry, Miss Seyed, don't worry. It's okay, it's not worth your health. It's going to grow back." My face crumbles. Like, no, I don't want to grow my mustache back. And I remember my mom looks at me and winks, and she had one of these, you know, flip phones, Nokia flip phones, fake calls my aunt and gasps and in shock turns around to everyone with tears in her eyes, I actually can remember that, and tells them the bad news. It's been lasered and it will never, never grow back. Everyone loses their shit over my side lip mustache. And I'm standing there trying not to smile because I know my mom knows and you know, she just wants to make sure we don't go through this charade again because she's the best. And she took me home like terrible, terrible little child, but also good job, high five. And yeah, death to America. I don't know, my mom's really cool.
Thank you. Hi, Sara. Oh my goodness. I love that piece. So this was an original monologue you wrote.
I did. It was a strange callback audition.
And they asked for you to write this monologue.
They did. They told us to tell, they basically said, tell us a funny story. And I was like, oh my God, how am I gonna tell them a funny? Cause you know, in an audition setting, like it's never going to be a ha-ha thing. And which kind of reminds me of what we're doing because we have an audience, but we don't have an audience. And it was a big deal audition for me. And I was, it's funny because I was trying to narrow it down into like 1 minute. This was more than that, but also it's just so heartfelt. It's a true story and it always kind of gets me. It's hits so close to home and I'm just so proud to share it.
Yeah. And your mom's a boss. I love right? that she just wanted to freak everyone out.
She is. What this always reminds me of is like how much our mothers, and I'm saying all mothers of immigrant children, have made sacrifices and stayed strong and have been such a light for all of us to kind of look up to. And this just kind of, you know, takes us there. So
absolutely. Have you been able to see your mom, or is she living in another state?
She lives in Iran.
Country.
yeah. I mean, before COVID, they were supposed to come. I haven't seen them obviously for at least about a year now, which is the longest I haven't seen my mother, but very blessed that I can do that, you know, with everything that has been going on. It's just, I don't want to get into that. We'll get into that during the talk back, but yeah.
Right.
Because I can go on.
I know.
Yeah.
Well, you know, the good thing about the pandemic is that we've all hopefully all been able to stay in touch with our families because they are so important during this time. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I know we have to keep going, but I know you will be back for the... We have what? One last act.
I know.
No,
Kristina.
But I know you'll be back for the panel, the talk back after our break. So we'll be able to hear so much more about you because you are a fascinating woman and I would love to talk to you forever, but they might yell at me.
Oh, I thought I was going to start drinking, but okay.
You can still do that.
love, guys. Thank you so much for everything you are.
Thank you too. And I know it's not on your name, but if you want to plug your social media handles in the chat or verbally right now, feel free to do so.
I'm at Sara Seyed on Instagram. Or you can just call me.
Perfect. Leave your cell phone in the chat.
Yeah, I'll do it. Why not?
All right. Yeah. Thank you so much. And we will see you shortly. All right, our final act is really special because it's our first duet. They quarantined and took tests just to be together for this performance. Please welcome the multi-talented Lisa Helmi Johanson and Keiji Ishiguri.
Hi.
Hi. Oh my goodness. How nice is it to be next to another human being?
Oh my God. Making music in the same room is... Everything wonderful.
I know, like hugging someone for, you know, the first time after months, you're just like, is this the right way to hug? Well, welcome both of you. There is so much talent in this one room right here. You are actors and singers and musicians and composers and so much. And, you know, KG, you're apparently the king of mashups. You've even written for Glee. Tell me more about that.
It's true. I have one arrangement that was on Glee. It's Rainbow Connection. So it's a good one.
Oh, that's great. And Lisa, I know you've done so many tours. I actually saw you when you toured in Avenue Q in San Francisco. That was like 10 years ago. I don't know. It was a while ago. But it was so fun to see you and funny to see you again here. A little more personable, person to person. What made you two want to work together and do this song together?
Well, initially it was because I was listening to a voicemail from Laura after talking with Keiji, and I realized that we were both asked to perform on this, and there were other projects that we were trying to figure out, can we COVID test and collaborate? And we're like, Laura, what do you think if we try to like do this together? She's like, yes, oh my gosh. So, and with the theme, we were like, cool, we're both mixed Asian, I call us hybrids. Of half Asian and half white, of different ethnicities.
I'm half Japanese.
And I'm half Korean. And at first we were kind of spitballing ideas of like, okay, you know, wouldn't it be cool if like, we did like part of it in Korean, like some K-pop or some like Japanese music, and then so like a mashup with something in English.
But then Laura went ahead and did that.
She stole your thunder.
But also actually, even before we knew Laura was doing that, I was like, wait. Either one of us has to be learning Japanese or Korean. So let's figure something a little more.
That's totally fair. Another time. well, what are you going to be performing for us today?
A special mashup. Mm-hmm. I think you'll recognize.
You'll recognize that
piece. Yeah.
Ooh. I'm so excited. You know, this is going to be so special because you're going to be wrapping up our show. So we won't have a chat afterwards. But thank you so much in advance for your lovely talent. I've heard it before. It's beautiful. Can you plug your social media handles now before we get started?
Sure. I'm mostly on Instagram. It's heart in a cage. So that's just heart in a cage without the eye on it. And then I also have a Facebook page, KG Ishiguri Music.
Mm-hmm. And I'm on Instagram as Hurricane Helmi. And Facebook, like a little on Twitter, but I don't know if that's worth even mentioning.
All right. Thank you so much. And take it away.
I see trees
much. Oh, that was fantastic. Thank you so, so much. KG and Lisa, that was amazing. Well, you guys, that concludes Act One of tonight's We the People. And could I actually get all the performers to come back for a virtual curtain call? I want us to applaud every performer for sharing their amazing talent tonight. This room is full of so many talented people. Just look at them all. All the clapping, yay! For any of our ASL friends. Thank you so much. Oh, do we have that big applause? We're now going to take a quick break, but hang tight and we'll be back in 5 minutes for our Act Two Talk Pack with Laura, Yumi, Snell. And feel free to start brainstorming any questions you might want to ask our special guests, who are Sara Seyed, who you saw earlier, Jason Janeo, and author Yumi Sakugawa, and drop the questions in the Q&A button that you see at the bottom of the Zoom. So thank you so much. My name's Kristina Stasi. You can find me on Instagram at stasi.kristina. Thank you all. See you in 5 minutes. Bye.
Sticking around for Act Two, the Talkback. It's always my favorite part where we get to know some wonderful artists in our community. And let me see, I'm gonna invite our wonderful panelists to come on and turn their cameras on. So Sara, who we just saw, are you here? Oh, perfect, perfect. Jason, so Sara, I'm gonna read your quick little bio in case people didn't know how amazing you were just from your performance.
Oh.
So, yeah, Sara is not only an actor, but an activist and an ambassador for the UN. Very cool. And Sara spent a good portion of her adult life practicing human rights law in London, working closely with Amnesty International and the International Bar Association. And she was well on her way to the UN as part of their legal affairs team until she was invited to audition for Juilliard. And she ended up going to drama school for a bit. That's where I got to know Sara, which is wonderful. And after getting her MFA from Harvard, Sara went on to receive international recognition in His Only Son and is now a series regular on the Netflix original Young Wallander. This is an amazing show. I hope you get a chance to check it out. And we are joined by amazing author Yumi Sakugawa. And Yumi is a second generation Japanese Okinawan American interdisciplinary artist. And so, and I said author because her published books include I Think I Am in Friend Love With You, which I have, and Your Illustrated Guide to the Universe, Becoming One with the Universe, which I also have, and The Little Book of Life Hacks, which was given to me as a birthday present when it first came out. So I feel like I own all of your books. They are amazing and wonderful and fun and deep and quirky, all the things you want out of life, and they make great gifts. So hey, holiday shoppers, I have a gift idea for you. And Yumi's also been published in BuzzFeed, Bitch, the Best American Non-Required Reading 2014, and exhibited multimedia works at the Japanese American Museum and Peabody Essex Museum and the Smithsonian's Arts and Industries Building. So quite an incredible resume. And we are now joined by Jason Janeo. Hi, Jason. So Jason over here is a New Jersey-born Dominican-American actor known for playing Ruby Martinez in Netflix's On My Block, an amazing show as well. I recently got into it and I am hooked. And you might recognize him also as Richter in Logan, so cool. And also Napoleon in The Get Down, another great show. So basically, Jason's one of the most sought after young actors in the biz. So we're so lucky to get to chat with him today. And we have a very special guest, super last minute edition, Navid Negahban, Sara's great friend. Thank you so much for joining us. We were so thrilled to be able to talk to Navid today. So Navid is an Iranian American actor, and you'll definitely recognize him from tons of shows, including 24, Homeland, FX's Legion, Netflix's Tehran, which is our artistic director Alex Pepperman's favorite shows, or one of the favorite shows. And he also starred as the Sultan in the live action remake of Aladdin, which was my favorite childhood movie. So I think we are just starstruck to be able to chat with you today. And thank you all so much for joining us. First, I wanna just check in and see how you are all doing in this weird quarantine life. Let's start with Jason. Hi. How are you doing? What's your life been like?
I'm doing pretty good. I just wanna say, first of all, congrats to everyone. The show was amazing. Everybody was so good. But my life for quarantine has been really good. I actually can't complain. I mean, I did, at the beginning of quarantine, I had actually had an encounter personally and with my dad with coronavirus. He was affected, I was affected. We're all good now, but it was kind of hard at the beginning. Now it's so funny because I think, you know, even though there's been so many ups and downs, I found a lot of ups in this whole 2020 thing. So I thankfully and luckily can't really complain about, you know, my life during this whole coronavirus thing.
Right, yeah. And you are currently working, right?
I'm not working at the moment.
Oh, you wrap.
No.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm wrapped. Mm-hmm, but yeah, I have had some projects that I was supposed to do, but then they got pushed, and because they were in different countries and stuff, and you know, the whole travel thing and the bands, and so everything's just kept getting pushed. But you know, I do have some projects that I'm supposed to be doing at the moment.
Yeah, and we will can't wait to see them when they're available for us. So thanks for being here today, because we're so lucky, because if he weren't here, you would have been in Bogota filming a movie, or so I heard. So
yeah.
Many exciting opportunities. Hopefully that still happens, just like when maybe when the weather is a little better.
When the world isn't ending.
Yeah. Yumi, how has your quarantine life been?
Hi, other Yumi. thank you so much.
Happy Rob. Yumi.
I just want to also say thank you to all the performers who performed. It was such a treat to be treated such a wide diversity of mediums and stories and voices from all of you. To answer your question, Laura, it's been an up and down cycle. I feel like it changes by the day, even by the hour. But thankfully, I feel like my quarantine experience has been luckier than most. I've been still able to work on my art, which is a pretty solo practice. And also this year, I really focused on teaching mindfulness and meditation through virtual webinars. So that's been a great way to connect with people during the pandemic. And I also started dating a guy right before quarantine. So,
so lucky. Oh, can't wait to hear all about that. Not in this professional setting, but in our late night catch up. Nice. Congratulations.
Thank you.
So exciting. I am amazed at people who are like, I met my partner for the rest of my life during quarantine. I know several people who were like, I took an online acting class and now I was in New York, boyfriend's in LA, and we met up and now we are official. Like, what? That never would have happened before quarantine. So, I mean, you were right before, which is even luckier. So, and I'm so glad you're still able to create, and maybe even more so because I feel like you have the space and the time. The hard thing is getting the energy up and finding inspiration when the world seems so dark. So I would love to hear more about your mindfulness techniques. But speaking of mindfulness, I need to ask Navid. Hi, Navid. Thank you so much for being here. I know the show became a lot longer than because we just wanted to chat with everybody. So I am so grateful that you were able to make this part of our show. And I saw one of your interviews and you had said, you will see the truth when you're blind and you will hear the truth when you're deaf. I feel like that's such a beautiful mindfulness exercise, wise words. Can you elaborate a little bit on that?
Yes. First of all, thank you so much. Thanks for having me. I'm sorry I'm barging in on all of you guys.
Oh, no, we're so lucky.
especially, please. I was trying to write to Samantha. I'm so embarrassed that I barged in on her with the video while she was performing. please, if you can reach out to her, tell her I'm sorry. I'm really sorry.
Oh my gosh.
I apologize for it. And see, the thing is that we grew up with all these voices in our heads, as the voices of our parents, our grandparents, our neighbors, the guy down the street, our principal at the school. And that is what forms us. It makes us who we are. Mm-hmm. And sometimes we carry their fears and their point of view as we get older. The best thing is that for us to find a ground zero. And when you find a ground zero is that you need to wash your eyes, wash your ears. You need to be blind. You need to be deaf. You shouldn't be looking at someone and judging the person based on what you have seen and what you have heard. Because every time that you're meeting a person, this is a new encounter. Mm-hmm. And you have to be blind. You have to be blind. You have to be deaf. You have to let this to come to you, not what you have heard and what the news is telling you and what the other people are telling you what it is. I traveled around the world. I'm a refugee. I was in a refugee camp in Germany. And our camp, it was really fenced camp with the barbed wires around it. And coming through that journey, you realize that you don't want to be like other people looking at others the way that they looked at you. Then you want to have a new point of view. And that's why I'm saying you have to be blind to see the truth. You see what is in front of you, not what has already, no preconceived mm-hmm. notions. I hope I was able to explain myself.
Oh, absolutely. That is those are such wise words. We all can live to encounter every single thing with fresh eyes, like a baby, or, you know, just the judgment doesn't need to be there. And I think we'll be so much happier for it.
That's it. I don't want to take too much mm-hmm. of your time, but I see the things that, for example, mm-hmm. I was working in Jordan. While I was working in Jordan, we had a security guard. The security team was were with us. We couldn't move around. And I told the guy, I said, I'm more in danger. You're walking around with a gun to your belt and a suit and tie in a village that everybody is walking with the sandals. Just leave me alone. Let me be. And those people, they took me in so warmly. I still have the gifts, the presents that the village people gave me to bring back. And all of them, they invited me to their homes and I was there and I loved it. I mean, that's how I see the world, and it's been beautiful.
Yeah, it's incredible. And I think that's especially important now in America, when it's easy for us to take on information from the media or wherever, and whenever we see artists on stage or behind the scenes, there are always like stories that we assume about people. And I want to hear from you all about any experiences that you feel like, you know what, my story is very different from the stereotypical stories you might see in the media or anything like that. Does anyone have a story they want to share about experiences where you wish they had come to you with a clean slate understanding of who you are? I can go Navid and then Sara. I feel like Sara, you had something to say.
I'm too old and I have tons of stories, so I will listen to you guys. I
love it. No, this is great. Jason? Do you have a story? Oh, you can think on it for a second. Sara, I feel like you leaned in to speak just now.
No, I would love to hear Navid finish. I cannot say enough about Navid. I literally told him about this an hour before the show. And this is one of the reasons I love and admire him, because he's just constantly looking for ways to give back in whatever way he can to the community of us artists. On that note, he's also creating this studio called the Romani Studio. For everyone who doesn't know, it's gonna be the
it's going to be this legendary studio in LA in which he's creating in an incredible space for artists to come, to perform, to put classes, hopefully after COVID. So many thanks to him. I want him to finish.
Wait, can I put that in the chat for everybody?
Absolutely. It's got an Instagram page called Romani Studios.
R-O-M-A?
I'll let Navid explain that.
Ah, perfect, perfect.
Is R-O-M-A-N-Y Studios. And is at Romani Studios. And it's a center, because when I came to LA, Sarah, you're terrible. You're bringing, I was just here to say thank you for having me, not this. the story goes far back. I mean, when I came to Los Angeles, I know that all of us, we have difficult times surviving in Los Angeles. And there were days that I have stories to tell. I slept on the park benches on the backseat of my car. So this is a facility that we have a studio space, which.
A real live rehearsal studio.
This is a sound station. Actually, I'm sitting. This is a fan where I'm sitting. And so it's a. Is a sound stage, and then we have a house that we can house up to 8 artists, which I'm still working on the house. I'm still trying to finish it. And then in the front we have a gas station. The building is from 1903, so it's an old building. Mm-hmm. And in the front we have a gas station that I'm turning it into an ice cream coffee shop. So the artists who are coming here, they can live in the house, they can use the facility.
Wow. And
at the same time, they can work at the ice cream shop if they want to make some cash. And we have space for street artists that they can come and paint the walls. Professional photographers, they come, they take a picture. At the end of the year, we will have an exhibition for them. Whatever is sold, the artists, they will get their money. And this has been my dream. I mean, I was, I wish I had this place when I got here. So I'm building it just to have it. I mean, wow. It's.
And can I just say, Soho Shakes, I've made a promise that Soho Shakes is going to put up plays at the Romani Studios.
Yes.
These wonderful people are incredible actors, artists, coaches, musicians, dancers. It's a beautiful place to like come together and, you know, do this, but together, hopefully after COVID. Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. Please, I hope so. See, the thing is that we just got our nonprofit. We became nonprofit entity. Yes,
congratulations.
Thank you. So the way that's going to work is that whatever the studio is producing, we are using some of the funds, the artists that we are raising funds to produce, and then when the production is sold, then we will donate some money back into the foundation for next artist. And this way, there's a circulation of the money that is being generated by the artist for the artist. Mm-hmm. So we are all paying forward, and all of us, we are family. I mean, this is, I started my career in Germany, and in Germany we had, they never cared where I'm coming from. I mean, I played French, Italian, Russian, Turkish, Iranian, Syrian. But unfortunately, here in America, our industry is very prejudiced. Mm-hmm. They're judging us based on the way that we look, our accent, and it's like that they have forgotten that when they go to see the signers here, 80% of the doctors, they are foreigners, and they have accents they have more heavier accent than I do. And our industry is kind of blind, and actually people like Yumi who are writing, you guys should be the ones who are generating. I mean, we need to have diverse voices that they are coming in. different colors mm-hmm. from different places for all of us to tell our stories and then support each other to create, to do something. Anybody is welcome. I mean, whatever I have is a piece of cake. Everybody can come, dip in, just taste it, do whatever you want to do. But at the same time, you have to take care of the place. The place needs to be running. So that's it.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing that. So exciting. And I'm glad you talked to Yumi, because I had my next question for Yumi, which was, how do you have your collaborative by yourself creative process? How do you generate ideas without a beautiful space like Romani Space or Romani Studios? Do you have your own like special desk or your favorite pen? What's your process like?
Well, I do have a morning routine that I do every day. So it's 20 minutes of silent meditation and three pages of a practice called Morning Pages, which is from Julia.
The Cameron. Artist Way.
Yes,
I just started
way.
That last month.
Oh, amazing.
Changing my life. We'll talk more about that too.
Yeah.
Boys and Morning Pages changed my life.
What was the first one?
Oh, boys, just having a boy or a partner in the life is nice. You're winning at
for
life
sure.
for me. So start with that, and then you go into your work writing, or do you use your morning pages as your creative generation process?
I see morning pages as sort of as turning on an old faucet and you're just letting the rust water run out before the water turns clear. So it's really just emptying out the trash of my brain, my subconscious. And to be honest, I haven't been very inspired during quarantine. I feel like I had to really just focus on a stable baseline of okayness. So I've sort of given myself permission to not pressure myself to work on long-term creative projects like books, which is what I usually do. And instead, sort of focus on just having fun creatively in a way that doesn't translate to finished projects or professional work. So for example, I've been cooking a lot, which is awesome, which is also a great skill in a quarantine. And also,
Sada's a great cook. So you get her phone number.
Amazing.
Trade recipes.
I can always use cooking and so. And also I've been taking movement classes, and I'm not formally trained in any way in dance or movement. So I've just sort of been using this time to just sort of fill my own well, to sort of recharge myself. It's sort of the inhale. It's a long inhale I'm doing before whenever this next exhale is going to happen. Just being patient with myself.
Beautifully put. Yes. I feel like I did a big exhale when Biden Harris was announced.
Oh, definitely.
Was like, oh. But it's still like, but yeah. Oh, that's so cool. And Yumi, can you remind me how you started? Because I feel like when I knew you through what elementary school and Japanese school, you were like always just kind of, I don't know, like quietly writing things, but I didn't have any idea your illustrations would like expand the world for all of us. Like, it's just so cool that you came up with these amazing ideas. What were you like as a kid? And how did you get your start in the creativity stuff?
What was I like as a kid? You know, I saw on Twitter something that made me laugh, which is that you're either funny or you had a happy childhood. I thought that was so funny. not to say that my childhood was completely unhappy, but I feel like I was just like really shy, really, really insecure, really kind of daydreamy and spacey. And I felt like, as I imagine a lot of people here, books and art and reading books and drawing and just doing creative, introverted things. Those were sort of my escape. And I feel like I just sort of kept doing it. And I just knew for most of my childhood and adulthood that I definitely wanted to channel these creative impulses into some kind of body of work that I could then share with the rest of the world.
Oh, wow. I feel like that's everybody's dream, right? To be able to do what you loved as a child and continue to do it as an adult and make money. So congratulations on succeeding at life. Like, that's just
thank
awesome.
You, all of us, I think.
Plus, yeah, yeah. Being
creative.
Yeah. I mean, I want to turn it over to Jason now as the youngest artist in this room. What was your beginnings? What were your beginnings like? What were you like as a kid? I mean, you still probably relate to being a kid because you play one.
But yeah, on the block, yeah.
It's just, you're so good at that. What were you like as a kid, and is it different from the characters you portray?
Well, I'm funny, so childhood was. I'm joking. Oh, no. I don't know. I think I was pretty normal as a kid. I was really family oriented. Like, we all landed in Jersey City. My father has 14 brothers and sisters, and they all decided that if they were gonna come to America, they were gonna, you know, all be in the same place. So I grew up within like a 1 mile radius of like all my aunts and uncles and cousins.
Wow.
And that's everyone I knew. And, you know, it wasn't until I was like 14, and then my cousins had moved to Pennsylvania, and that's when I had to branch out on my own. I think that's when like I sort of fell into the whole acting thing, because I was like, well, I kind of want to do this. And now that I have time, it was like sort of a blessing that they left, because I think I probably would have just like stood in that whole world where I'm like, you know, my cousins are my best friends and I just want to hang out with them. But when they left, I was like, let me look for something to do that's just for me. And so I did that, and it didn't work out too well. Like, I tried going to like these acting schools, like in elementary school and whatnot, but I just couldn't get to them. Like, I got accepted, but we didn't have a car to take me there. Like, I was too young, and like my parents worked or whatnot, so they're like, I can't really, it was like after school programs. So then when I was 17, turning 18, I was like, let me just try one more time, because my guidance counselor keeps talking about college and I'm really scared. So I was like, before I go to college, let me just give it one more shot. And so I had signed up for the Barrel Group in New York, and they didn't want to, like, I auditioned, you have to audition to get in. And then I kind of was like emailing them back and forth. Cause they're like, well, you were good, but you're only 17 and this is an adult class. And I was like, I promise you, 2 days after the class starts, I will be 18 and I will technically be an adult.
That's amazing.
And so they were like, and then like a week later, they're like, okay, you can join. And so awesome. That's how I got my start in all of this.
Right. Yeah. And you basically got discovered, right, by our wonderful manager Lori Smith.
Yeah, I love her so much. It was just a showcase at the end of the year. And we just all had to prepare a monologue for him. We'd walk in, and I was like really nervous. And so I let everyone go ahead of me. And then finally I was like, there was one guy who was like, no, I'm going last. Like, you have to let me go last. And I was like, okay, fine. And also, I'm taking the train back home, so let me just hurry up so I can leave. And then I just did it, and she was just like, she's just there, and I don't know, she's just like, here's my card, and just talk to me. She's like, are you still in school? I was like, maybe. She's like, talk to me when you're done with this. And oh, so I did. Mm-hmm. And that's, yeah, it was through a monologue with Lori Smith. The rest is
so fantastic. Yeah, Lori is the best. Oh, that's so great. It's also so refreshing to hear origin stories like this. It's just like, you know, every artist started somewhere, and it's amazing. Like, all of your careers are in this incredible place already. And to think that, you know, I feel, my personal opinion is that artists of color sometimes have to work way harder to prove ourselves. And so my next question was going to be something along the lines of, you know, what do you love about being an artist of color, or what have your biggest challenges been being an artist of color? especially in 2020. So while you think on that, I want to give a quick little update about our fundraiser, because thanks to the incredible artists that join us today, we are so close to hitting our $4,000 goal. I mean, $5,000 our main goal, but we're just at $3,989.55. We're so close. So if anyone who's here can help us get over to the 4,000 mark, we would be so thrilled. And remember to keep sharing about us, and we just love your support, because then we can support our artists. So now we're back to the panelists. I think this is gonna be one of our last questions, so let's make it good. Just kidding, no pressure. Does anyone have any stories they want to share about what they love or find challenging about being an artist in 2020? Sara, and you.
This is interesting, because I think everyone would agree that we're loving the shift that is happening. I mean, there's the industry is finally championing diversity and ethnic ambiguity, but I think a lot of people would probably relate to this. And I think Navid pointed out that it's the early stages, and they're sort of trying to define, and Hollywood always does this in the beginning, which is a very sort of, they have this tunnel vision of what is the other, and a lot of it has to do with how people look. So what, as Navid was saying, like, obviously I'm Persian, funny enough, and on every legal, one would think that I'm an artist of color, but like, there's disagreements about that. Because literally on every government official paper, we're like Caucasian, because they don't have a specific thing, like Middle Eastern. So, and what's been happening, what I've noticed is, like, a lot of times, because you don't look very much of one thing, you won't necessarily get cast, even for like a Persian role or somewhere from the Middle East, because you're sort of in between the shades. And you know, there's this, which kind of takes me back to a lot of auditions that I've done. Like, I was, I'm not going to name them, but I remember losing one to a wonderful, beautiful lady who was African-American. And I was like, I was thinking to myself, and we constantly amongst friends, we talk about this, is that, and I know this might sound controversial, is that an overcorrection of previous scenes? And I was like, no, this is a start. This is like, this lady is going to pave the path for the next generation to come. And I know a lot of it has to do with, like, obviously money, because these production companies want that diverse, because as you said, America, the society we live in, is diverse. Like, you cannot open the window and not notice how beautiful and colorful the world out there is. And they're tapping into that, and you can sort of kind of like doubt their intentions, but does it matter? Does the intention matter when the ends justify the means? So I think the shift is great. I think personally, yes, there have been times where I go, oh, I lost it to someone who looked more Middle Eastern than me. Like, you know what I mean? Right. Whatever that is.
Yeah.
Because it's like a whole, you know, there's like tons of countries in that region. Whatever.
Half
means.
Of the show was about being mixed race, right? Like, our freaking emcee was like, who am I?
Yeah.
No one knows, like, where to place us.
You don't even fit, because you're like ethnically ambiguous. And that's sort of like, what, I mean, what range does that put you in? When you, especially in this, as we talked about, we already have to compete against well-established artists who have credits a lot more than others. And then we have to kind of, as Navid was putting, that we assert the fact that we have the skills, we can do different accents, we can be different things, we have different stories to tell. So I think, you know, just to kind of summarize, I think we're in the right direction, and, you know, we're gonna lose out on stuff, but it's happening, and we should get on board, and we should, as Navid put it, and Yumi was saying, we should create our own work. And every now and then, in the midst of this darkness, there's like a crack, light shines through. You know that you're amongst your own community of people who are like-minded and want to do things. So it's just a matter of communication, planning, and getting things done.
Yes. Oh, I love that summary, Sara, the lawyerly summary, the closing
statement. I should go back to that.
I mean, no, never. We need you as an artist. The world needs actress Sara Seyed. But also, like, I just think it's fascinating because on a personal level, I used to go in for only Chinese-accented English roles. That was like 6 years ago, right? And now all the roles I get to go in for are like, they don't ask for accents. Like, it's kind of actually rude if they ask for accents. They're writing roles for people like me or you or you or you. You know, it's just awesome because they're finally bringing more diversity to the creative process. So it's an all-around
win-win situation. Remember you were telling me you went to an audition where they asked you, can it be more Asian? Remember that?
Yeah.
And I was like, what does that mean?
You want me to talk like this? Terrible. I'm so sorry.
Yeah.
But yes, we are in a better place now. Still lots to go. Still much further to go, but progress is something we should celebrate. And Yumi, you had your hand up for answering this question. What was the question? Oh yes, your joys and challenges of being an artist in 2020, artist of color in 2020.
I think what?
Sorry, I just got distracted by the chat. Shahjehan was like, they asked me to please make it more Egyptian.
Oh my gosh, wow.
He's like, I'm not Egyptian though. What does that even mean? Yeah, and Kristina doesn't fit anymore. Okay, I'm so sorry. I won't interrupt.
No, that was awesome. I think because all this diversity consciousness that's finally happening is such uncharted territory, I think then people who are not represented have not been represented. I feel like we then get to basically invent our own genres and be pioneers in whatever we put out into the world, because it is going to be one of the first or singular things that no one else has seen. And speaking for myself, I went to UCLA. I was never formally trained as an actor, but I was in the Asian American theater group at UCLA that was founded by Randall Park, and Ali Wong was also an alumni of the theater group. And I remember back then a big sort of the buzzword was just like, oh, representation, we need more Asian American faces in the media. And certainly so much has changed in the last 10 to 12 years since I've been in college. And I think now I see the conversations becoming more nuanced, where it's not just about representation, but more so how do we also not only bring in more representation, more diverse faces into the media, but also how do we change the very power structures that create things like gatekeeping, create things like those boxes, those binaries of like, oh, Asian enough, Egyptian enough, ethnic enough. How do we challenge the very standards that we are fighting so hard to get into? And of course, it's a nuanced question with many complex answers, and we get to answer that through our own communities and life, work, and collaborations. And so basically we get to create the future that we want, because nobody knows how to do it. So we get to, I think there's freedom in setting the precedent for this big unknown.
Wow, that was so beautiful and inspiring and also daunting at the same time. I think you're so right. Like, it is up to us, the artists, to speak out and make sure that we are creating the future that we want, not just as artists, but as people. And we have the power to do that if we want. So just the collaboration and the speaking is so important. Yeah. And we need people like you, Jason, the super young artists of this generation, to build a better future.
I'm trying.
And I want to make sure you get a chance to answer. Like, do you have any fun stories of when you were like, I love the fact that I'm an actor of color, or this is really challenging because I am an actor 100%. Of color?
Yeah. I think as an actor of color, it's like this love-hate relationship where Hollywood sometimes over tries for your story. And I kind of almost love that because it takes you out of the norm. You see these movies, like the general, like, you know, when like you get a love story and then, you know, people that who aren't of color, like they'll get The Notebook, which is amazing, whatever. But then people of color, we get Moonlight and things like that. And I think sometimes when they create a story of color, you get to reach a little bit beyond what the general norms are of what Hollywood has been telling the whole time. And mm-hmm. many times it can be, you know, better than what has been advocated or told as like the general love story for so many decades, you know? So mm-hmm. I think like there's this love-hate relationship where when Hollywood does tell a story for someone of color, it kind of steps a little over the normalcy. And I kind of mm-hmm. love that sometimes. I mean, sometimes it's a little mm-hmm. little too much, but then other times it's like, especially as an actor, you're like, oh, I definitely want to do that because it's, you know, well, you gave the normal role to like that guy, that mm-hmm. white guy, but then you wrote this like crazy John Leguizamo type of thing for me. And I totally want to portray something like that. So
right.
I sometimes hate it, and sometimes I'm like, it's only gonna create a better character for me. And other times I'm like, well, here's the stereotype and whatever, I guess I'll do it. But you know, yeah. it's this balance and this love-hate relationship.
Right. You sometimes play by the rules so that you can break them later.
Right, yeah. right.
Yeah. Beautifully said, Jason. Yeah. I hope to see you play all of those roles. Yeah. Navid.
May I say something? Jason, I love what you are doing, but know one thing. You yeah. are the one who determines mm-hmm. how the people are going to see you.
100%.
You have a voice. Whatever the script is, I have worked on the projects and I walked in, and sometimes the writers, they don't know what they're writing because they're not that familiar with that culture, with those, mm-hmm. They don't feel it. Your job as an artist is to go in and bring those words to life, bring that work to life. So you are the one who can show them what it is. So don't ever be silent. Don't ever be silent. I've worked on the projects that there have been projects that I walked in and I had a meeting. I'm so sorry. Barging him, I love what you are doing. The thing is that I got invited to New York. They flew me to New York. They set me up in this beautiful hotel. I had a meeting. I'm going for a meeting. I'm walking into a room. The person says, they can make or break my career. And they're saying, wow, you're from Persia. I said, yes, I'm Persian. So what part of Persia? Iran or Iraq? I said, well, what can I tell you? I mean, this was, it used to be, now it's not anymore. This is what it is. So I came back and I got a package, a video about history of Iran, a lookbook of all the different looks in Iran, the geographic book, and an animation that shows the history. I packaged everything with some pistachios and baklava, and I sent it to New York. I said, I would like to introduce my cousin to you.
Oh, man, that's amazing.
So you are, mm-hmm. as they are saying, that you are the next generation.
Mm-hmm.
You are the one who can make a difference.
Mm-hmm.
You are the hope mm-hmm. of the future. You are the one who can make a difference. All of us, each of us, we have an expression in Iran. We say, others kash, digaran kashtan, ma mikhorim, ma mikarim ta digaran bokhoran. Which means, others planted a seed, we are enjoying the fruit of it. Now we are planting a seed for next generation to enjoy the fruit of it, of that mm-hmm. tree.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of seed are you trying to plant?
Mm-hmm.
That is what is important, and just keep going. I never looked at myself as an actor of color or Iranian actor or Persian actor or German actor. I speak five different languages, but I never cared about attaching myself to any of those cultures. Mm-hmm. I'm just me. Mm-hmm. I'm just an actor, and nobody else is like you. Nobody else is like me. Let them say whatever they want to say. There is no label.
Right.
keep all these labels away. At the end, take your color away, take your religion, take your nationality, take where you came from, strip everything away. At the end, what is left is just a pure sort light. Is it light? Is a source of light? Is a pure white light? Is just something that's inside you? That spirit could have landed anywhere. And that spirit, there is no difference between me, you, Sarah, Yumi, or Lara. All of us, we are the same.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Oh.
So make that difference.
Thank you. I am
giving you a standing ovation through this Zoom. Thank you. Those were such beautiful words. You should also write a book because we could all learn so much from you. Yeah. And, you know, I could keep talking forever because this is so inspiring, but I want to wrap this up just so we can all take our lights and go do something with it out in the world.
So I also, Laura, I just want to say something just as an extension to what Navid was saying. And I think this is extra important for young artists who are so worried because we're constantly gone, like we're basically, you know, pushed into these situations in which every sort of decision we think can make or break us. And I remember, now Navid's here, I'm going to say, Navid was like, I think you even told me, you were like, make the decisions that are right for you in the long term. And because of I remember specifically on a very personal note, when I went for the show, this last one, I had this like fully fleshed dimensional, like woman who's from the Middle East. I mean, initially she wasn't going to be, but then I put it on an accent. They liked it. We ended up going with that. But then they started cutting down on the sort of sexy, funny, humorous, charismatic scenes with the husband. And I was like, it wasn't, for me, it wasn't about cutting the scenes or having less lines or having less footage, which obviously is important for all of us actors. For me, it was like, I chose to do this because I felt like it's a chance, it's an opportunity for me to represent where I'm from in a much more dimensional and fully fleshed way. So as Navid and Jason and Yumi and all of you guys were saying, just piggybacking off of what you all are saying, I think standing for what's right, even though at that moment feels very dangerous and you feel vulnerable and you think, whoa, if I were to email, which I did, by the way, I emailed the writer right off, I hadn't even seen him, met him or anything. And I wrote this long email about every scene and why I think this should be there, thinking, whoa, my manager's gonna think, this one's, I've got a crazy one on my hands. And she probably did, but it created an amazing relationship between me and the writers and the producers. And it felt like now my character is an extension of me, not just this other thing that I'm working on. So yeah.
Right.
If my daughter were here, she would have told me, Dad, you talk too much. But let me say this. I was auditioning for a project. I said something and the director was in the room, very well-known director, and he told me, what is it that you're talking about? What are you saying? I said, I said the lines. He said, no, these are not the lines. I said, no, these are the lines, but the way that you wrote it, it doesn't make sense because this man has a journey. There's some, he's not just a madman. And I said, the director walked out of the room. Literally, I said, shit, I just lost the job. Why can't I keep my mouth shut? But then I was proud. You know what? I said what I wanted to say and I'm proud of myself. No problem. I'm walking outside. The director is waiting outside the room. He grabs my hand. He takes me into the office. The rest of the cast is sitting there. I'm just auditioning for the part. He's taking me into a room. He calls the writer, well-known writer, come into the room, sat us down and said, right now, rewrite the character. This is the character that I want to see. See, sometimes they don't see it. And every door, as long as you are truthful to yourself and who you are, trust me, you will meet the people who they see you. They want to work with you and they want to see the truth. And those are the people that you want to work with. If you are working on a project for a year long, you don't want to be miserable every day you are going to work. Mm-hmm. You want to work with the people who they see you. Every door that closes on you, slams on you, every part that you're losing, it wasn't your part. It's just a road sign. It's a direction. It tells you, you know what? Turn right, turn left. You will get there. As long as you're truthful to yourself. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, I'm talking too much.
No, apologies. This is wonderful. Thank you all for your generosity and your wise words. I feel like we're all so much more inspired now. And I feel like I can go out and like plant my seeds and break down doors and share the glass ceiling and all of that. But
go do it. And if you want... Yeah.